It's r/pro-revenge time. In a world where entitled parents often win, we voicey veterans can start to get discouraged in our fight. But even if they always seem to get the upper hand, don't lose hope. There's always the option of some sweet, sweet pro-revenge. That's right, some entitled people are going to finally get their just desserts in this episode of Voicey Hears Pro-Revenge. This fan-submitted story was called, "Your gas pump is not working properly." What? You don't care? Well, me neither. Well, where do I start? This happened to me last week, and honestly, not only was it a funny experience, but it was also quite beneficial too, to myself as well as a few others. So I recently bought a new car, and I'm all head over heels about it, since it's my very first brand spanking new car that smells of, well, brand spanking new. It's a Peugeot 508 RXH Hybrid, diesel and electric. And after a month and a half of cruising and using it for everyday business, the time finally came to fill it up for the first time. I head over to my usual gas station and start to fill her up. After a bit, I noticed while the gas was filling up normally, the currency amount was barely moving. It was digital, so I figured something was up and stopped pumping. I head over to the cashier and the conversation went like this. "Hey, there's something wrong with the pump. It's not..." I get interrupted.
"You need to squeeze and keep the trigger squeezed."
"Huh? I know how to pump gas, I'm just saying that the counter is..." Interrupted again.
"The pump is fine, just keep the trigger squeezed. And what, you don't know what fuel your little brand new rich person car uses?"
Yeah, this douchebag really said that. Me frowning from lack of patience. I know exactly what fuel my car uses. I want to... Third interruption.
"You want the manager? Yeah, sure, just a sec."
"Wait, what? No, I'm just trying to say..." He then yells the manager's name and sure enough, here comes the manager.
"What's the problem here?"
"He doesn't know how to work the gas nozzles. Says there's a problem with them."
"The nozzles are fine. Here, come with me, I'll show you."
By this point, I'm dumbfounded that they both do not let me get a single word in, but at least now I'll be able to show the manager the problem with the currency counter. He then proceeds to take the diesel nozzle out that I was using and starts filling up the tank. I then noticed the counter was barely moving like before and tried to tell him. "Yeah, I know how to use it. Just look at the counter. It's..." Another interruption.
"Don't worry, once the tank fills up, the pump will automatically stop."
At this point, I was done. Don't want to listen? Fine. I don't care. "Thank you for your assistance, I think I've got it from here." The manager then heads back to the store with his nose high up, thinking he got to teach a clueless rich boy how to fill gas. I filled up my 72-liter tank to the brim, which would have cost me almost 80 euro, but ended up paying less than 30. I went home but was still ticked about it. Eventually, after playing with my daughter and getting into a few video games, I forgot about it. 3 days later, my wife tells me she needs to fill up her car as well, and asks me for my point card. When I was about to hand her the card, I had a bit of a smirk. Instead, I took the car myself and went to the same gas station. I thought to myself that they probably fixed it by now, but still, I had this gut feeling. I rolled up to the same pump and started to fill it up. Lo and behold, that thing is still broken. This time I said nothing. I quietly filled up my wife's car and again paid less than 30 euro for the full tank of diesel. But I didn't stop there. Oh no, no, no. It's time for some r/pro-revenge. I'm an Uber driver and I work for a small company that has 12 cars under their fleet. I call up my boss and ask him if he needs any cars refueled, and he says that yeah, most of them are in need of a top-up. I explain the whole thing to my boss, and he did not believe me. I tell him to meet me up at the gas station and use the indicated pump. Still a bit suspicious of the whole thing, he drives up with his car and fueled it up. After paying up, he quickly met up with me and told me to call half the guys on duty and he would call the other half. 30 minutes later, 4 Peugeot Travelers, 4 Dacia Logi, 2 Audi A8, and 2 Mercedes CLA were all queued up at the same gas pump, waiting to get fueled up, even when there were 5 other empty pumps. Cashier was a douchebag and manager was a condescending butt wipe, and neither wanted to listen to what I had to say, so I took their stupidity and turned it into saving money. I noticed a few days later that all the pumps had been replaced by newer models, and they were now functioning properly. Dunno about the cashier idiot, didn't see him there again, but the manager is still there. The hero of the story had no obligation to even tell them that the pump was broken in the first place, but both the cashier and the manager decided to judge him based on the car he drove, and they ended up paying the price, quite literally. This story was called, "Want to go on vacation and not pay us for work? Won't be home for a few days after informing us?" Sure, my grandpa is on my do not ever mess with list in any way. Shortlist. Taught Shotokan overseas in Korea, one of the highest ranked black belts outside of Japan. I've seen security footage of some of his bar fights, it's legit. Was a personal bodyguard during the 70s for some governors in our state. Worked construction for decades. One of two master carpenters in my state. Which leads to the story. During summers, I would work with Gramp doing a lot of his manual monkey labor. Shingles up on the roof, mixed concrete, sand floors, keep everything tidy, etc. He'd been screwed over the years as many general and subcontractors are. And as the years went by, his contracts for work go more and more specific, i.e. payment on a certain schedule, new or unexpected cost, and how they're dealt with, etc. One particular job started out pretty normal. He's hired to build a new deck with a new patio slash driveway patio for this guy. Let's call him Crap Brain. New construction, newer house, easy job. Gramps had even done work for him in the past, no problems. Deck is to be partly covered, 10 by 50 on the front of the house, 4 foot up the concrete stairs, brand new door, brand new picture window, 4 by 8. Driveway is to be stained, freshly poured between the new deck and the garage Grandpa built a few years ago. Guy was even going on vacation for a few weeks. We can get the job done in those 3 weeks if we bust it. Guy pays 50% of the estimated cost up front, and was to pay the remaining 50% over the agreed time. Now, this first payment covered all material for the original estimate, and paid us basically minimum wage for the hours we'd put in. The next few installments would cover the subcontractor for pouring the driveway, and the remaining hourly wages. Weekend one passed. No agreed payment. Guy's on vacation. Maybe he forgot to set up autopay? Whatever. Send him pictures on AOL email. The original concrete stairs had been removed. New door was in place. Deck was framed out. But we didn't hear from Crap Brain. Weekend two passed. Crap. No pay yet, but work needs to be done. Concrete guys are here for the new slab and stairs. Let's get it done so we can move on to new jobs. Subcontractor is a longtime family friend and distant relative. Call him Timmy. Does us a favor and pours stains on an IOU. Send more pictures on AOL. No response from Crap Brain. Week 3. We finished our work 2 days early. Subcontractor has finished their work. It looks amazing up there on a nice hill. But we haven't been paid for this work. Gramp finally gets Crap Brain on the phone.
Hey, how's the vacation?
Blah blah blah, skip forward 3 to 5 minutes. Gramps is a talker, and lived in the vacation state for a few years.
Great, glad you had a great time while I was busting it here. Holy heck, it has been hot. What did you think of the work?
Oh, looks great. We'll be home later day after tomorrow. We're having a get-together with XYZ.
Well, glad you're going to enjoy it. Oh hey, seems like your bank didn't pay us on the scheduled agreement.
So?
Excuse me?
So what? I'm not going to pay the rest of the money. Work's done. Tough luck, you old man.
I understand. Click. Well up, let's get to work. Oh, and get Timmy on the phone.
Crap Brain had that large garage Gramp had built years ago, and the guy let us use it to store equipment while they were out. First, the brand new door was removed and placed in the garage. Then, each piece of the brand new deck was removed and placed into the garage. Sadly, the posts were 36 inch deep, but hey, a 4x4 truck pulled those out of the ground nice and good after a bit of shoveling. Those were also placed into the garage. Window was also removed from the frame and placed on top of this pile. Deconstruction is much faster than construction after all. Timmy was rather unhappy as well about not getting paid, but hey, we found out that the new stairs we poured moved well enough across the new driveway patio, and some bleach took care of the stain we put onto the patio. Sadly, it had a few chips in it from all the ruckus, and someone made the time to take a diamond saw and cut all the way through the seams. Sadly, it'll now settle at an uneven rate, but all the material Crap Brain paid for, he got to keep. We even went into the garage in the evening and made sure his front door was locked. You know, for security. Even the few tools we needed for the job, which Crap Brain paid for, stayed in the garage. Fast forward 2 days. Crap Brain comes home and throws a crap storm. It had stormed, and his AC had been running non-stop with the increase of draft into the front of the house. Of course, he threatens Gramps with a lawsuit and the police. which just made Gramp laugh. A close relative was the assistant chief of police in our small town, unbeknownst to Crapbrain. We did everything we were contractually obliged and paid to do. All the equipment, all the materials were in Crapbrain's possession. That is, after all, what he paid for us. He blustered a lot, but it did nothing. Fast forward a bit, no one in the local union will deal with this guy. Gramps and Timmy are both pretty well respected and do a lot of great work around town. Someone from out of town ends up fixing the issues and does a crap job of it. Darn. The best part of revenge like this is that there's no way he can complain. Even if he didn't have a personal connection with the officer, he had only paid for half the job, which really only covered the materials. I'm sure they would have still much rather the pay, but there would have been something satisfying knowing that, well, if you're gonna mess with me, you're not gonna completely get away with it. This story was called Mean Lady Hates Everyone, Especially Us. We buy her house after she failed to pay her debt. The house we live in was built at the same time as hers. My parents were often at the construction site and help if they can. The strange lady was nice to us at the beginning, but that changed soon. This happened around Christmas 2017. We have a neighbor who is very unpopular in our neighborhood. She is well known for harassing people who use the public path at the left side of her house. The path is one out of three to reach the public playground behind her house. If someone uses the path, she would scream at them that this is her path on her private property, which is wrong. Sometimes she would close the path with a red and white plastic chain and wouldn't let anyone use the path. She would scream at kids on the playground when they were loud, at daytime. She always has her shutters almost down so she can stalk people on the street and stay unseen. If some kid's ball landed in her garden, she would bring it to the kids and destroy it with a knife right in front of them. All kids knew this, and they would run by her house if they wanted to go on the playground. When the neighbor's kids were playing in the winter outside in the snow, she would call the CPS equivalent in my country and tell them they were locked outside by their parents as a punishment. If someone walked by her house at night, she would often call the police due to a noise complaint. She was known by everyone in our neighborhood as the witch. But she hated my family in particular. We lived right beside her house. Our houses shared one wall. When me and my sister were young, we would use the swing in our garden or jump on our trampoline. She would regularly file noise complaints and often harass me and my sister when we were alone in our garden. If my parents heard her screaming swear words at us from the first floor of her house, they would yell back. If me and my sister walked on the path by her house, she would scream at us. We used the path daily on our way to school. One time when I came home from school, she was in her car, with the trunk on the sidewalk. When I walked by the back of her car, she howled the engine, and the dark exhaust hit me. Almost every night, she would hit the shared wall with something to wake us up. Sometimes she'd ring on our door and try to make us go to other neighbors to complain about small things. We often had lawsuits with her. One time because her tree grew 2 meters over the border. Another time because she built a fence by sticking bamboo mats in the dirt and tearing it down the next day, and telling the police we destroyed her wooden fence. We won all lawsuits against her because my uncle, he's teaching law school, gave us good advice on how to deal with her and named lawyers he knew were good. She never paid the workers who repaired things at her house and the electrical and water bills. When her old car broke down, she didn't pay the car mechanic and never got her car back. She was in debt and had a mortgage on her house. When the foreclosure came, we were at the court and bought her house. She was with us in the courtroom when the auction was and tried to buy her own house, but wasn't allowed because she couldn't provide proof that she has enough money. We bought her house where she lived for 20 plus years in front of her. We bought it because my parents were at the construction of her house and knew the workers did a great job of building it. We renovated it when she left. We repainted all rooms, renewed the insulation, and put everywhere where there were no tiles, with new wooden floor. My grandparents will be moving in her old house this fall. You can just imagine this in like a movie. There's just the scene where the witch has to leave the house, and all the neighborhood comes out, they start rejoicing, yay! They can finally walk down the path to the park again in peace. Now, I wouldn't wish for anyone's house to be foreclosed on, I'm sure that's a traumatic experience. But if there's anyone who's going to be kicked out in your neighborhood, you're going to want it to be this kind of lady. This story was called Don't Steal My Brother's Newspaper. Some years ago, my younger brother attended college to get an electrical engineering degree. In his junior year, he lived on the 8th floor of one of the school's residence halls, which were multi-story apartment buildings. He always had a thing for the comics page in the Sunday paper, so he was one of the few students in the dormitories that actually subscribed to the local newspaper, which was delivered to his door in the wee hours of the morning. One Sunday morning in October, he found he didn't receive a paper and called them up. The carrier insisted that the paper had been placed outside his door, just as it had been for the previous 5 weeks. He figured it was a simple mix-up, but it still bothered him. The following week, he woke up when the newspaper was delivered, but fell back asleep. However, when he finally got out of bed that morning to retrieve it, the paper was gone. He then knew there was a newspaper thief who was specifically targeting him. Now, my brother has always had a very pragmatic approach to life, and also has a very creative mind. He realized that he didn't want to wake up at 3:45 a.m. for the rest of the semester just to keep his own newspaper. He also knew it could be any one of the people who lived around him, so he really couldn't ask around. He was forced to put his formidable engineering skills to work on how to solve this problem. The next week, he set his alarm for 3:30 a.m. and was awake and at the door when the newspaper was delivered. He thanked the carrier and took it inside. As soon as the carrier was gone, he opened his door and placed a special replacement newspaper outside his door, with one corner just barely tucked under the edge of his door. Then he went back inside, shut the door, laid down on his stomach near the door, and waited. After about half hour, he saw a pair of shoes walk up to his door. The corner of the paper quickly disappeared, and he heard soft footsteps run towards the elevator. The next thing that happened was pure chaos. A full pack of firecrackers suddenly went off in the dorm. Shouting students came streaming out into the hallway to find out who was lighting off fireworks. Note, students don't like being woken up by firecrackers at 4 a.m. They tend to get crabby about things like that. The students followed the acrid smell of burnt gunpowder to the elevators. There on the floor by the elevator doors was my brother's newspaper. Shredded newspaper littered the floor, and the newspaper had a big hole blown in it. My brother quietly reclaimed what remained of his newspaper and turned to face his fellow residents. He then explained about how he had been the target of a newspaper thief and how he had dealt a little engineering justice to the perpetrator. He had built up a tiny set of contacts. Think of two pieces of springy metal, which touch in one spot, and hooked up wires to them. He had then placed a small plastic strip between the two contacts to hold them apart. He connected those contacts to a thin piece of nichrome wire, like what you find inside your toaster but much thinner, and a coin cell battery. The nichrome was woven into the fuses of a full pack of firecrackers, and the whole contraption was taped inside a center section of his decoy paper. By design, the battery wasn't big enough to instantly heat up the nichrome wire. There was about a 15 to 20 second time delay before it'd get hot enough. He was also smart enough to use masking tape to hold the connecting wires together against the pack of firecrackers, so when they exploded, the detonator would be rendered inoperable. A small hole in the piece of insulating plastic allowed a short piece of fishing line to be tied from it to the doorstep. So when the thief had grabbed the paper, he had pulled the piece of plastic out from between the contacts, thus lighting the firecrackers. The residents did find a few pieces of shredded newspaper in the stairwell and lobby, indicating the path that the thief took once the paper exploded. My brother was forgiven entirely for waking everyone up, and even gained a certain amount of respect that night for the clever way he had used his engineering skills to deal with the thief. He never had another newspaper disappear on him for the rest of his tenure at school. He gave me the contacts and piece of plastic shortly after he graduated, and I still have them to this day. No one's gonna wanna wake up at 3:45 a.m. every day just to keep their own newspaper, but who wakes up at 3:45 a.m. every day to steal someone else's newspaper? I'd much rather pay the subscription fee just to get my own delivery to know that I can sleep through the night. It must have been more than just the newspaper. There must have been a kleptomaniac who just got a thrill from stealing this guy's newspaper every single day.
If you'd like your story to be narrated by me, don't forget to visit the subreddit r/voiceyhere, link below. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe if you'd like to see more. Alright, I'll see you in the next one.